What PC parts do you need in 2022? This is a follow-up video from last year's 2021 version, and a few things have changed. So we're going to recommend a build for Star Citizen. It's going to be a relatively high-end build. I've done a minimum spec video. You can check that one out if you're looking for a low-end build. But this is how to get relatively good performance in Star Citizen. So there's lots of things to look at. Let's get into it. Now, before we just jump straight in, let me just give you a summary. If you've played this game before, you may be fully aware that CPU is absolutely critical to this game's performance. You might be sitting there with a really good GPU thinking, what's going on? Why is my performance so bad? It's probably your CPU. The game is brutal on CPU and really quite unoptimized. And as I say in every single video, and I've been saying for a long time, that hopefully will change with the Gen 12 renderer and Vulkan API, but we were hoping all last year and they only got a tiny bit of it in. So hopefully 2022 will be the year, but as we go into the recommendations, just be aware, as much as you might think you want a new GPU, it's probably a CPU that you're after. This time last year, I was sat here recommending the Ryzen 5000 series, and that still is a very good recommendation. The Ryzen 5000 series are very good for Star Citizen, good performance, significantly better than previous Ryzen generations. I did a video testing all the different gens against each other, and the 5000 series is really good. But then Intel finally got itself into some sort of shape to release decent products and released Alder Lake. And so I tested the 12700KF, the i7 part, and it really is quite good. It's significantly better than the Ryzen 5000 series. And you have to say, if you are looking for a brand new system, you've got no parts previously, you'd have to go with Alder Lake for Star Citizen now. The IPC improvements, just the general performance, single threaded performance of this CPU, of these CPUs, they're brilliant. And so, yes, that's where your best performance is going to be. The recommendation probably changes if you've got a current kind of, say you've got a 2000 or 3000 series Ryzen CPU, it probably isn't worth jumping all the way across to Intel, new motherboard, everything like that. You're probably best still upgrading to the 5000 series from AMD if you've got a compatible motherboard. So that's that. Which model you go for? I've kind of for a while now been saying the 8-core thread, 16-thread models are probably the ones that I'd go for, because that gives you a bit of future-proofing in terms of if Star Citizen is finally able to use more than that. But as the recommendation was last year, 6 cores, 12 threads, there's no real benefit going above that. But future-proofing, maybe the i7 or the 5800X would be the options to go for. Let's talk GPUs, and try not to laugh your way through this one, because obviously getting a GPU these days is almost impossible. So you can't buy them really brand new for any sort of reasonable price, and if you buy them secondhand, you just get completely ripped off as well. So, we'll attempt. The best bet probably is to stick with what you've got. But some things have changed in Star Citizen this year. So, volumetric clouds have been added to the game, and these are pretty brutal. So they're in Orizon, and they're also in Microtech. And I've done some testing, and you're gonna want a fairly hefty, it raises the floor for what graphics cards can run. Now, you can reduce the settings of the volumetric clouds, and actually on medium settings, they're not too tricky to run, but they don't look great. So if you're sat here thinking, I've just got so much money, I don't even care, you're gonna want to go fairly high end. But for everybody else, you probably can just deal with turning settings up. Let's try and recommend this in the different resolutions. This is the Tom's Hardware hierarchy page, part of their website. Load of graphics cards. We're gonna just talk very, very quickly about recommendations for different resolutions. Basically, anything RX 6800 upwards, 4K, probably 4K 60, high refresh rate 4K is probably for the next generation from both AMD and NVIDIA. Then anywhere down here, I used to have a 1070 Ti. I'd say that's just about a 1440p graphics card. It depends on what you accept as good frames or acceptable frames, but anywhere up from here, probably up to the, I mean, that probably, these are probably overkill for 1440p, but not quite enough for 4K. But anyway, anywhere in that range, 1080 Ti is still obviously great, 2070, 2070 Super, all these sorts of RX 5700 XT, all these sort of cards be good for 1440p. Then if we go below that, what is the lowest card I'd recommend for 1080p? And the minimum spec card that I recommend is the 1066GB. Performance will not be great with that card, that's the minimum. So really anything upwards of there will be fairly decent, but do some research. There's plenty of YouTube videos, all the big hitters, Hardware Unbox, Gamers Nexus, everybody like that. Check out their videos on these cards, compare to other games and see what sort of performance you can expect from these cards if you're going to buy one. VRAM is obviously important when you're buying GPUs. You don't want to be in a position where you run out of VRAM. That, I don't think, is a massive issue with Star Citizen. I've done some testing at 1440p, and we were still talking about 6 gigabytes of VRAM being used. That's not particularly crazy, and actually, the game will obviously run with less, but I would say 6 or 8 gigabytes. If you're buying a new one, probably go 8 as a minimum. But 4K, obviously, you might need more, but then all the 4K cards that you really want to buy will have more than 8 gigabytes anyway. So VRAM isn't much of a problem, I wouldn't say, at this point in Star Citizen. The other thing that's really worth talking about, though, is upscaling technology. So we've got NIS and we've got FSR from NVIDIA and AMD. And these technologies basically do vaguely the same thing. They take a lower image quality. So say you're running a game at 1080p and they upscale it, say, up to 1440p. Now, what that does, it allows you to get the benefits of the graphics card running a game at 1080p, so you get better performance. But also the image is slightly better than actually a 1080p native image. So it's upscaled to 1440p, and it doesn't look as good as native 1440p, but it looks better than native 1080p, if that makes any sense. Basically, it's free performance and it looks better than running at the lower resolution. So that is worth really considering, and I've made a few videos on that, should the footage all have been up on the screen. And if you're thinking that, oh, I want to upgrade my GPU, it's just not quite got enough performance for Star Citizen, I'd definitely suggest looking at some upscaling tech before you try that, because, yeah, you could save yourself a lot of money by just using upscaling whilst you wait for the GPU prices to sort themselves out. Next up, let's talk about RAM. 32 gigs of RAM has been recommended for a while. I've been recommending it for a while, and that stays the same. 16 gigabytes will run the game. Sometimes you have to fiddle around with the page file, but it's not as smooth. You don't really get any more performance by going to 32 gigs. You don't get more FPS, but in general, the experience is just much better. Less hitches, and it's, yeah, I would just recommend, if you've got the money, get 32 gigs of RAM. The speed, I've done some testing again this year in terms of looking at the speed, and surprise, surprise, the faster the RAM, the better performance. We're not talking masses, though, if you look at the graphs up on the screen, but there is performance to be had if you're looking for every single frame that you can get out of Star Citizen. The elephant in the room is DDR4 versus DDR5, and the elephant evades me. I'm trying to buy some DDR5, but I can't get any. It's just completely out of stock everywhere, but it is going to be worth testing. And it's, if you're holding out for whether Alder Lake platform you should go for DDR4 or DDR5, hopefully I'll get some testing done in the early part of this year and we'll be able to answer that, because I think potentially the likely answer is that DDR5 might be better for Star Citizen, but until we've tested, we can't know for sure. Storage, pretty simple. Just get a SATA SSD. That's the general recommendation. Hard drives are awful and horrible. Don't do that to yourself. But NVMe, M.2, Gen 3 and Gen 4, no real benefit in loading times over the SATA drive. And then the only way I could find any real benefit was to put 2 Gen 4 drives in RAID, and that got me a few seconds when loading into the same server. There's no performance benefit. You don't get more frames by having a faster storage device, but you can get a couple of seconds or a few seconds if you go really, really fast RAID. It's not worth it. It's not worth the money, in my opinion. There might be other reasons why you want really fast drives, but for playing Star Citizen itself, I can't recommend more than just a standard, decent SATA SSD. Next up, let's get into some sort of extras, the accessories, the fun things that add to the Star Citizen experience, but you don't need to have. If you've got some spare money, you want to buy some extra things, this is where to look. First up, I love joysticks, and I try and say that in every video that I mention joysticks. They're brilliant. I've been recently testing 2 against each other, and yeah, I think 2 is the way to go, but just getting into the joysticks in the first place is definitely worth looking into. So check out that video if you want to have a bit more in-depth look at that. You've also got eye tracking or head tracking. Toby and TrackIR are the main ones. There are a few apps out there and a few ways to do it without those, but I tested Toby a year ago and it's brilliant. It really works really well. And yeah, it seems to be becoming the recommended option for the Star Citizen community. Yeah, you can't really go very far on Twitch before you find somebody with Toby eye tracker, but it is very good and I would recommend definitely checking that out if you are interested in that sort of thing. Face over IP is also quite funny when it comes to Star Citizen. I did a test on this and basically what I found was, if you can get anything with 60 FPS, that's the best case scenario, but probably best bet, first of all, is to test it with a phone, and there are ways to do that, and that will give you an idea whether you even enjoy that sort of thing at all. It can be quite fun and funny, but it's not critical to the Star Citizen experience, I don't think. Something that I think does really add to the Star Citizen experience is Game Glass. Now, I did a video on this, and basically it's a way to use any surface, any screen or tablet surface, to extend your controls of Star Citizen, and it is really good. You probably want a relatively new tablet or phone, but on the whole, I enjoyed this a lot, and I think it does really add to the experience of playing Star Citizen. Let's talk monitors. I am a massive fan of G-Sync and FreeSync. I don't think once you've seen it or you've played on it that you can go back. Having just that buttery smooth, no screen tearing experience is incredible. And obviously V-Sync does something like that, but it isn't as good, and you sometimes have to drop the frames down as well to get that. So G-Sync, FreeSync, I think are brilliant, and I would highly recommend finding somebody that you know who has a monitor if you haven't got one with G-Sync or FreeSync, just so you can see what it looks like. Because yeah, for me, having done it, I could never go back. The main thing, obviously, though, with a monitor is the resolution. We are moving into a period of time where 1440p is relatively affordable, depending on your budget, obviously. So 1440p, I think, looks dramatically better than 1080p. But 4K is stunning. This game, I think, is made to be played at the highest resolution possible. They've obviously, the assets, everything they design, they're trying to make this game look as good as possible. And really, at 4K, it does look incredible. 4K, though, is a nightmare to put a build together for in some ways, because you're having to get a really high-end GPU, which they cost a fortune, and you're also having to spend a lot of money on a monitor. So it really is only for those of us who have got lots and lots and lots of money and have got spare cash to spend on those sorts of things. But I'm weighing up whether I should jump across to 4K, because it just looks so good. But with all this stuff I've said, as with last year, this could be not the right time to buy a big PC for Star Citizen. This could be completely the wrong moment. In some ways, we know more this year than we did last year, and so it's easier to say wait, because CIG, in theory, will actually get their Vulkan API transfer across into the game this year. And in theory, that will bring better performance for CPUs. And as we said, CPUs are the core part of Star Citizen performance. That's where you're looking to fix most of your bottlenecks. But that could change this year. Our CPUs could be better utilized and not as dependent on a few threads like they currently are. Also, as we said, as we always say with these things, PC parts quickly come out, and as soon as you buy one, it's out of date. As we said, the CPUs are all going to come out from AMD and Intel this year, the 3D cache stuff, the AM5 platform from AMD, and then Raptor Lake potentially might come at the end of this year, and that will bring better performance. So as always, you have to weigh up when is the right time to buy a PC part, or just build a whole PC. It's up to you whether you want to take the jump now or wait for better performance. But as we always say, you could be waiting for better performance for literally ever. That's how this thing works. So I think that's enough for this one. Quick announcement, I am opening up a Discord server. And basically, I want this to be a place where people can discuss all this sort of stuff. The tech stuff, the Star Citizen build ideas, what do you need, what parts do you need, what do you use, any technical issues you've got. I want it to be that sort of place. But also, based on a survey I did a couple of weeks ago, I would like it now to be a place where people can group up, because we had this survey, which made me a bit sad really, that a lot of people just don't have people to play with, or at least it's tricky to play with people. So the Discord server will partly be a place to do all the stuff that this channel is about, the technical side of Star Citizen, talk about that. But also, I want to make a casual place where people can group up. This isn't like a very highly organized org where there'll be lots of very military operations going on in the game, but just somewhere where you can say, hey, anybody fancy playing now? And hopefully that will kind of provide a place that people can do that. So we'll see how it goes, but we're going to open it up and you can join Discord. The link will be below. If you like this video, like it, subscribe if you like this technical look at Star Citizen. You can join the channel, become a member, and send money through the air so I can build more PCs and test more parts. But that's enough. I'll see you soon. Bye.